Hi guys, so in today's video we're looking at probably the third most common thing or problem I come across after direct sort of lower back pain and after sciatica is having sort of like pain but only in one hip, sort of on the front of the hip, or like the hip tends to feel like it kind of locks up and you can't use it and it's very hard to get going again. So for some people, if you're really unlucky, it can be pretty sort of debilitating, it can be quite an aggressive, you know, sort of throbbing pain. Tends to really affect people normally, mostly at night. It was sort of the sort of tenderness in the hip or the throbbing pain will kind of wake them up. They don't want to sleep properly, which in itself, if you've got bad sleep, generally tends to make sort of muscle aches and pains worse anyway. So it becomes a bit of a vicious circle. So what we'll look at today is we'll kind of try to understand why you get it. The clue is in the fact that it's in one hip and not in both of them. And then give you some strategies or a little program to try that should give you a bit of relief, kind of restore the hips to sort of normal function and get you out of trouble. So let's look at some of the possible causes having sort of pain in one hip. So generally in the cases that I come across, it's actually pretty simple. It's just that it's infuriating because you know, people feel sort of out of control with it because they don't understand what's causing it. They don't realize some of the stuff that they do day to day is actually what's contributing to it and making it worse. So the big clue is that it's in one hip rather than the other. So for me, I can get tightness in my left hip. And if I don't keep it in check, eventually that will start to annoy the back again. So I'll keep on top of it. So for me, if I don't pay attention to my triggers, it will start to throb, just feel generally tight, start to keep me up at night again as well. But that's just a reminder for me that I've kind of forgotten to keep the basics in check. So what causes it? Well, basically it's just that you've got kind of an overuse of certain muscles in that hip compared to the other one. And generally it means that you're always tending to put that hip into closed positions or weird positions all the time subconsciously, and you don't realize it. And that's what starts to cause the problem. So you end up with sort of certain muscles just being on and angry and not necessarily overactivated, but just kind of doing too much of the work and they never really get a break. That's why they get really pissy. It's like I said to you, you know, hold your right arm up all day, you know, sort of after 20 minutes or so, you're going to be in a lot of pain because it's going to be stiff and just angry. What you don't realize is the similar thing can be happening with your hips, and subconsciously you're doing sort of repetitive movement patterns or movement habits that are making that worse. That's akin to holding that arm up all day long, but you're doing it with your hip, and certain muscles are just being on all the time and never really get a chance to sort of stretch out and relax again. So if it's, you know, say for example, it was my left hip. Normally, it would mean that you tend to put that hip in very closed positions. What I mean by closed position is sort of like this, or even turned out slightly and kind of like that. Also, the big one for a lot of people is the way they sleep. They'll generally sleep with the bad leg. They'll try and sort of tuck it up. So they'll kind of sleep on their front and tuck up like that, or they'll lie across and pull it up into a really closed position all the time. So those sort of hip flexor muscles and like your TFL muscle especially are just in a shortened position all the time, just generally just basically on and trying to hold your leg up for you all the time, like getting a break. So first thing you do is to understand your aggravating movements and postures and start thinking about in day to day, with that hip, do you put it in weird positions? Do you tend to put it up like that when you sit, or do you kind of sit with it tucked up a bit more? Is it crossed over more on the other side? When you sleep on your side with this leg tucked up? You know, is it in a shortened position a lot more than the other side? Sometimes, well, for some people, it can just be driving in cars because they got one foot in a weird position compared to the other one. So what we've got to try and do is identify those movements where that hip's in a very closed position and try and minimize them, and definitely don't sit in a position that makes it worse, you know, sort of either sort of tucked up like this or with one leg up, something like that. You've got to try and take those out. Once you take those out, you know, it will start to settle a little bit because you're not continuously re-aggravating it. But the tricky bit is also because of subconscious movement habits and postures, is, you know, paying attention to when you do that, or maybe getting other people to point out to you when you do it, so that once you become aware of them, then you can start to work and try and take them out of your sort of daily movement repertoire and stop re-aggravating that hip all the time by putting it into a closed position. So the first thing I want to do is I want to try and release some of this tightness. So I'm going to assume that it's my For me, it's my left leg that's the tightest one. So we're going to do, first of all, the first stage of this little program. So we're going to do a little bit of work with the foam roller just to get it to let go just a little bit so we can start doing other things. So we do carefully down. I'm just going to be on the mat. You can do it on the floor as well. Down to all fours. So I'm gently propped up with my forearms. Got the roller in here. What I'm going to do first of all is I'm going to scour with the roller all the way down towards the top of my knee. I'm just going to see where my worst spots are. Chances are, if you have got a problem with the hip, it's going to be right at the very top of the quad, top of the leg, almost into the actual hip itself. And you should find there'll be a tight spot or two in there. Your goal is to find the very worst spot you can find, then put as much pressure on it as you can stand. Now this is the trick. The leg and the roller stay still, but we're going to do these pull throughs like this. So I'm not going up and down like that. I stay still on the point, heel up to the bum like this. If it's really tight, you might find you'll be doing tiny little movements like this initially. As it starts to let go, you can kind of get a little bit bigger with it. But we're going to do sort of 1 to 2 minutes like this, a bit of preparation work on the really bad hip. You do the other hip as well. What's most important is that we do the leg that tends to give you the most grief. Let's try and get these muscles to let go a little bit, so you can have a little bit of respite with that hip from locking up. But again, 1 to 2 minutes, just keep the heel moving, about a second up, second down. Try and unglue those tight spots. Try and get rid of as many as you can. So, we've loosened up the muscle a little bit with a bit of what we call self-myofascial release with the foam roller. So what that'll do now is that it will mean that the muscle will have kind of been forced to relax and kind of a bit more pliable. So now's a good time to give it a stretch. So what you do is you just sort of right angle L shape with the legs. Squeeze the glute a little bit if you can. Just pop the hip forward just enough so you feel that stretch in here. So you're probably more likely to feel it right in front of the hip if it is the hip that's a problem. But don't be surprised if you feel some down the actual quad itself. And all we've got to do is we're just going to stay like this, nice and simple. Just give it a minute each side on each leg. Give it a good stretch. So we've released a little bit of the foam roller. Bit of movement now to kind of stretch it out and try and get that muscle to relax just a little bit more. Just so we can get a bit more movement out of those hips. And once you've done a minute on one side, just swap to the other side. Same idea. Just pop the hip forward. Squeeze the glute a little bit. Try and stretch out some of that stiffness in the front of these hips. See if we get to let go a little bit. So now we've rolled the hip, get some tension out, we've stretched it to kind of restore some of the movement and take even more tension out. Now what we need to do is start to kind of, re-educate the hips, is a term for it, but just get them moving in a way that's going to encourage muscles that might be sort of a bit sort of sleepy to kind of wake up and get some of the muscles that are a bit tight in the front to let go even more. So one of the best ways, or the safest ways to start with that is what we call a glute bridge on the floor. So I'm on my back. In terms of feet position, if you put your hands to your sides, you just better touch your heels with your fingertips. Want feet roughly hip width to shoulder width apart, about a 5 degree turnout, and then you can just put your hands wherever you like on your sides. Once we're set up, what we're trying to do without even moving is kind of squeeze the glutes a little bit and then squeeze through to come up until eventually we get to the top and they'll be completely locked in as tight as we can get them. You should find the hips are nice and straight. Now, if you're already tight in the hips, one or two things might happen. You might find it really hard to squeeze the glutes on. They'll feel a bit vague, which is fine. It's just going to take some time and just keep doing sets of this circuit I'm showing, this little program, and it will start to become more and more clearer. The other thing is that you can get the glutes to squeeze on, but it's just a bit tight in the front. You feel like it's stretching. That's not a bad thing. But what we're going to do is sort of like a 10-second stretch. Come down, let it settle, squeeze for the glutes, squeeze back up again. Squeeze as hard as we can for 10 seconds, get them both glutes engaged, the same as each other. Get these hips in a more of an open up position, let things stretch out a little bit. Come down, like that. And what you do sort of sets at 8 to 12. And you should find, as you go through successive rounds, this little program, it's going to get easier and easier to feel the glutes, and it'll be easier and easier to kind of squeeze them from the floor. Don't panic if you can't. It's kind of normal for most people not, you know, when I say to them squeeze on the floor, they've got no idea what I mean. But it's fine if you sort of squeeze up and you don't really feel them, so they kick into here. What we want to make sure though is that when you do this, you don't feel like pain in your lower back and definitely no cramping in your hamstrings. So if you do start to get any of those sort of problems, your goal is to better iron those little kinks out and just better use this as a glute strengthening exercise. And you should find that the looser the hips get on the front, the easier it is to squeeze the glutes, easier to get more clear signal. The easier it is to send the clear signal to the glutes, the looser the front hips will get. So this little routine is one of the best ways we're in sort of trouble when one of the hips is kind of spasming, you need to kind of get to let go, or it's keeping you up at night. This sort of hip restoration program will sort of get it all to let go for you. So summary, so when you've got pain, crippling pain almost, in one leg versus the other, number one thing is you've got to identify the times that you're putting that hip in a tight, closed position. Minimize those times because it's basically just re-aggravating the problem. Then we can do that little routine I showed you. So we're going to do some self-myofascial release with the roller. We're going to roll in there and we're doing those pull throughs. We're trying to get some elasticity into that muscle, try and get just to relax just a little bit, start to let go a little bit. Once we've got that, then we can stretch it with that kneeling stretch that I showed you. So you've got to squeeze the glute on the same side, pop the hips forward just a little bit, feel that stretch in the hip or in the quad. About a minute each side, get both hips, you know, to let go a little bit. Then once you've got that, now we just start to restore some movement and try and restore some of the kind of the balance of tightness to different muscles around the hips. So we help with a glute bridge on the floor. So obviously we lay on the floor and then we're trying to squeeze through the glutes. Big 10-second squeezes. End goal is try and get the glutes to burn if you can, a nice clear signal. But just keep practicing, it should get easier and easier the more you do it. That whole routine, my advice would be to do it 6 times a day. You should find it each round, it'll get a little bit easier each time as the hips start to let go. And once the glutes, you can feel the glutes a bit more, generally is a good sign. You'll find that this kind of tightness in the single hip will start to disappear. Now, long term, that isn't gonna fix all your issues because there's probably a good chance, because it's in one hip, you've got like a lateral stability issue. So that's kind of your body's ability to protect you from unwanted sort of, you know, lateral flexion in your lumbar spine. That's when you need to look at things like, you know, Shin McGill's big three, so McGill curls, side bridges and bird dogs, to kind of lock it all together. Once you've kind of got that on top of it, then you can go back into your regular training, as long as you're smart, and you should kind of be on the path to, you know, staying out of trouble, as long as you keep these hips moving. But anytime you have a bit of a flare up, you just roll back into the little routine that I showed you today with the roller, the stretch and the glute bridges, keep it all ticking over. Other thing I'd say in terms of training, you want to be very careful. If you have got an angry hip muscle in the front, like your TFL or a hip flexor, things like walking lunges and split squats, there's a good chance they'll just aggravate it and make it way worse, especially if you've got some weight on there. So my advice would be to limit that sort of stuff. Focus more on exercises that help with kind of getting the glutes going. So things like glute bridges, RDLs, that sort of stuff, that just kind of stretch the hips out that way and get the glutes a little bit stronger. Because generally, the stronger the glutes are and the more that you're aware of what they're doing, and the more, you know, more clarity you've got with signal going to them, the more likely your hips are going to be nice and flexible and not be prone to kind of getting locked up in one stage. That covers the kind of the basics. Obviously, I don't know about your individual case, because it depends. But as a general rule, before that little routine, you probably find most people get a benefit out of it. At least definitely get you out of trouble on the days that it's really bad.